the Upanishad series. Trust the fragrance of surrender. It is difficult to surrender to a stone or a river or even to a master. It is difficult. When it is difficult to surrender to a master, then surrendering to a stone is not only difficult, instead impossible as well. Because whenever you see a master, then again your mind says that he is a human being like you. You know his past, so why surrender to him? And your mind cannot see the present moment, the flower that has blossomed into him, the change that has taken into him. You cannot see this all. That is why it becomes difficult, because mind lives in the past. It cannot see this very moment. And unless you are able to see this very moment, you will not be able to surrender. So for that, there has to be a rapport. He is like you in a way, and yet he is not in a way. You recall the incident when Jesus was to carry the cross on his shoulders up to the hill. It is the human element. Jesus, the son of Mary and Joseph, is carrying that. He was expecting a miracle to happen. If you watch only the visible in him, the man carrying the cross, but you are not seeing his innerness. If you are seeing only the visible, then he is the stone and you cannot surrender. If you love, if you become intimate, if you allow his presence to go deep into you, his presence to go deep into you, there becomes a subtle connection between you and him. This is what is called rapport. Indeed, rapport cannot be with his visible aspect. It has to be with his being. Suddenly you become aware of the plus point that he is. He is more than a human. In some unknown way, he has something that you has not got. You are simply a stone out of which Michelangelo has not used his hands. I had told you about this story of Michelangelo. He used to spend his time by a shop. As usual, we, after the day's work, in the old times when we did not have the other sort of entertainments, so people will go to a nearby a shop where people will gather, all kind of talks will take place. So he used to spend time by that shop. At the back of the shop, there was a big piece of stone. At times, in his moments of solitude, Michael will go towards the stone and will continue to look at it from different angles, as if he is trying to envision something in him. But that piece of stone was of no use to the shopkeeper. He was a pure businessman. So one day, to the surprise of Michelangelo, the shopkeeper said that, "I will give you that piece of stone because I am cleaning up the place." So Michael said that, "I do not have the money to pay you for that." He said, "No, I am giving you that." And he did not have the money to even get it transported. He said, "No, I will get it transported to you." So the shopkeeper, who wanted to get rid of that stone, arranged to get the piece of stone reached to Michael's place. Michael started working on it. Every day he will chisel out something. He will create. Couple years passed, then one day, when the shopkeeper has completely forgotten about the stone, Michael told him that, "I want to show you something." So the shopkeeper wants to know, "What do you want to show me?" He said, "No, you have to come to my house." When the shopkeeper reached, he wanted to know what he wanted to show him. The entire piece of stone, the carving, was covered, was shrouded. And when the shopkeeper reached, he uncovered, and the tears began to flow from the eyes of the shopkeeper. He wanted to know, "How did you create this?" He said that a sculpture was hidden in the stone. I simply chiseled out the unwanted stone from around and polished so that the real carving may manifest. Now, a piece that was an ordinary piece of stone has become something that the shopkeeper could create a rapport with. So something has happened through the invisible hands in Jesus, that he is no more than a piece, a mortal being, as you have known now. There is something added to it. Something has evolved out of him. And when you understand this, you will feel this beyondness. There is something invisible that you cannot imagine has happened to him. And that will create a rapport. And because of this rapport, trust is born in you. This rapport, Patanjali calls as Shraddha or trust. Certainly, trust creates the rapport. Rapport is an inner harmony of the two invisibles. You have an invisible part of you. The other has an invisible part of you. When the two invisible parts connect to one another, there comes a harmony, and that becomes rapport. Love is the rapport. With somebody you simply fit as if you were both born for each other. You call it love. In a moment, even at the first sight, somebody simply fits with you, as if you were created together and were separated somehow or the other, and now you have met again. On the dumb bosom of this oblivious globe, although as unknown beings we seem to meet, we are not aliens, nor as strangers join. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. There is a power within that knows beyond our knowings. We are not aliens, nor as strangers join. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. That causeless force creates a rapport. In the old mythologies all over the world, it is said that man and woman were created together. In Indian mythology, they have a very beautiful myth. The myth is that wife and husband were created in the very beginning as twins, brother and sister. Together they were born, wife and husband, as twins, fitting together in one womb. There was rapport from the very beginning. They were together in the womb, holding each other, and that is rapport. Then, due to some misfortune, that phenomena disappeared from the earth. But the myth says that still there is a relationship between a man and a woman. The man may be born here, and woman may be born somewhere far away in Africa or America, but there is a rapport. As soon as you see something beyond the physical, you are connected to the invisible part, and that is rapport. And unless they find each other, there will be difficulty. And it is very difficult to find each other. The world is vast, and you do not know where to go and seek, where to find. If it happens, it happens only by accident. Now, scientists also believe that sooner or later we will be able to judge the rapport by scientific instruments. And before somebody goes for marriage, the couple has to go to the lab so that they can find whether their bioenergy fits or not. If it is not fitting, then they are in an illusion, and this marriage, this relation cannot survive. They may be thinking that they will be very happy, but they cannot be, because the inner bioenergy does not fit with one another. So you may like the nose of the woman, or the woman may like your eyes, but that is not the point. Liking the eyes would not help. Liking the nose too will not help, because after 2 days, nobody looks at the nose or at the eyes. Then the problem is of bioenergy. Then inner energy starts meeting and mixing with each other. Otherwise, they will repel. It is just like you transfuse blood. Either your body accepts it or rejects it. Because these are the two types of blood. Same way the bioenergy differs. Only if your body accepts the type of blood, then there will be something. The same happens in a marriage. If bioenergy accepts, it accepts and there is no conflict. There is no conflict of any kind. It will work, but it is very difficult to know about it. Love is very fallacious because love is always focused on something. Love that we understand is not the energy, instead it is focused on something. The voice of the woman is good, or you are attracted to her appearances, to her eyes, to her nose, or maybe a particular style of her appearance. But that is not the point. It is a partial thing. The whole must fit. Your bioenergies should accept each other so totally that deep down there arises harmony. And this is rapport. It happens in love rarely, but there is no way how to find it. It is still difficult. Just falling in love is not a sure criteria. Out of 1,999 times, it fails. Love has proved a failure. Even a greater rapport happened with the master. The moment you are connected to someone at the physical level, sooner or later there comes a conflict in the flow of the bioenergy between the master and the disciple. It is greater than love. There is no connection at the physical level. Yet there is something beyond the understanding. You cannot call it love because you do not relate to the master just as you relate to your beloved. This particular aspect of love, where the physical being is not involved, is known as trust. Between the husband and wives, the couple, it may not be necessary to be there, but if it happens there, then a rapport comes. Not only your bioenergy meets and fits, but your very soul also fits together. That is why whenever somebody becomes a disciple, the whole world thinks he is mad. Because the whole world cannot see what is the point. Why are you going mad after this man? What he has got? And you cannot explain it also, because it cannot be explained. You may be even not aware consciously what has happened. What this man, suddenly you are in trust. Suddenly you are in trust. Suddenly something meets, becomes one. Somehow or the other, deep within, you feel, whenever I have a problem, I will call this person, and just his presence, a word from him, will sort out the problem. This is rapport. This is something beyond love. It is difficult to have that rapport with a stone, because it is even difficult to have that rapport with a living master. How can you have with a stone? But it has happened. Immediately the master, the moment that rapport becomes possible, there is something invisible is born. A Jesus becomes a Christ. He may not be God for others. He may not be Christ for others. But for disciple, he is God. And through him, the doors of the divineness opens. Then you have found the key. The inner rapport is the key, the surrender. Then you can try it. Then you can surrender to a river, to a stone, and to anything else. You must have read Hermann Hesse, who won the Nobel Prize for his work on Siddhartha. His personal life was very difficult. Read his personal life, and he was able to create a distance between his personal life and what he projected in Siddhartha. He had a very broken family relation. But his novel Siddhartha won him the Nobel Prize. He learns there is a mention of a river. He learns many things from the river. You cannot learn from a Buddha just watching the river. And he mentions of many moods of the river. He has become a ferry boatman, just watching the thousands of climates around it. Sometimes the river is happy and dancing. This is how he mentions. Sometimes the river is happy and dancing, and other times very, very sad, as if not moving at all. And sometimes very angry and roaring against the whole existence. And sometimes so calm and peaceful, like a Buddha, a graceful. Imagine he is using these attributes for the river. Sometimes the river is so happy, as if in a dancing mood. Other times it is sad. And sometimes very angry, and roaring against the whole existence. And sometimes so calm and peaceful, like a Buddha. Hermann has been able to express those wavering moods of the river through his writings. And this is the beauty that I have found. I was wondering what has made it is this made this novel to won the Nobel Prize. It is the ordinary story of Siddharth, but the way he has projected, Harman has been able to express those wavering moods of the river through his writings. And I feel it is for this aliveness that he was given the Nobel Prize. It is for this. I happened to meet someone and discovered this, that my observation was correct. It is for this wavering moods that he has been able to express through his writings of the river, as if the river was alive. Whenever he feels saddened, he rushes to the river. You would have always also seen at times when you are in a very disturbed moods, you go to a place, you go to your chair, you sit down on it, and as if something of a calmness descends in you. Try to figure out with what in your life that you have been able to establish that kind of rapport. Desk, on your chair, as if a calmness descends in you. Something happens to you. And Harman was able to create, express those wavering moods of the river through his writings, and I feel it is for this aliveness he was given the Nobel Prize. And Siddharth, simply a ferryman, passing the river, living near the river, watching the river with nothing else to do, understands the process of rivering. An analysis of Harman Hesse Siddharth. Sometimes I wish if I get an opportunity, I would like to teach the poetry and the deeper aspects of it. Siddharth, simply a ferryman passing the river, living near the river, watching the river with nothing else to do, understands the process of rivering. It becomes a deep meditation and rapport, and through the river and the riverness of it, he attains. He attains to the same glimpses of as Heraclitus did. Just being by the river, through the river, and riverness, a word coined, riverness, of it he attains to the same glimpses as Heraclitus did. If you look at the life of Harman, you cannot believe that a man with much wretched life could produce a work like Siddharth. In creating this work, Harman reached to the heights of consciousness that even Buddha has not. When you look at the prophet of Khalil Gibran, he has reached to the heights. However, his whole life lacked awareness. And this is the reason he had a miserable life. Had he been within the energy field of a Buddha, certainly Harman would have been an enlightened one. And Harman died unenlightened, but he created a work. You can step in the same river and you cannot. The river is the same and not the same. It is a flow, and through the river and the rapport with it, he comes to know the whole existence as a river, riverness. It can happen with anything. The basic to remember is surrendering. It is surrender to God. And surrender to a master is the same, you asked. Yes, surrender is always same. It is just up to you to whom you are able to surrender, with whom you are able to find a rapport. Find the man, seek the river, and surrender. It is a risk. Indeed, surrender is the greatest risk possible. That is why it is so difficult to surrender. It is a risk. You are moving in unknown territory and you are giving so much freedom to a man or to something you surrender. You do not know what is going to happen. If you surrender to me, you are giving a total power or authority to me, then my yes is your yes, then my no is your no. Even in the day I say it is night, you say yes, master, it is night. You are giving total power to someone. The ego resists. The mind says this is not good. Keep control of yourself. Who knows where this man will lead you to? Who knows? He may say a jump from the hilltop and then you will be dead. Who knows? This man may manipulate you, control you, and then exploit you. The mind will bring all these things. It is risk, and the mind is taking all the security measures so that you do not surrender. The mind says, be watchful, watch this man a little more. If you listen to the mind, surrender is not possible. Indeed, surrender is not possible if you listen to the mind. Surrender happens only because of the rapport, and rapport is because of love, and love blossoms. Love is the fragrance of the heart. Mind is right. It is a risk. But whenever you take, it is going to be a risk. Watching would not help. You can watch forever and may not be able to decide because the mind can never decide. Mind is confusion. Mind is always indecisive. It can never take the decision. You have to bypass the mind. Someday or the other, you have to tell the mind, you wait. I go, I will take the jump and see what happens. If you have that much courage, you can jump into it. I am reminded of the story of Maujood, the Sufi story. Maujood means literally one who is present. In this story, the name of the man is Maujood. Probably I will narrate this story tomorrow. He was walking like anybody else, and if he had continued in his job, he would have retired. He would have reached a high place of eminence in his work and retired from there. But all of a sudden, he meets the mysterious guide of the Sufi, the Khizr alayhi salam, and he tells him to tear away this garb and jump into the river. Maybe someone may save you. And he jumps. This is how the story of courage is the story of Maujood. I will narrate it tomorrow once this is finished. What you have got to lose, really? I always wonder what you have got that you are so afraid to lose. What exactly you are bringing when you surrender. You have nothing. You can gain out of it, but you cannot lose because you have nothing. You can always be profited out of it, but there is no possibility of any loss because you do not have anything to lose. You may think your chastity may be at risk, but you remember your body is a vehicle. You need the vehicle to reach to a destination, and you ride into the vehicle, you reach to the destination, and when you reach the destination, you hop out of that place. So human body is the vehicle, the mind, the eyes, everything, all the sense organs, organs of perception and action, these are the vehicles to take you to the destination where you have to reach. The ultimate is to reach to the destination. Whichever vehicle you use, and it is not important otherwise. You have nothing to lose. Even if you are miserable, you are somebody. Even if you have a hell within you, at least you have something. But watch this, observe this. And when you surrender, remember you have nothing to lose. A master is taking your misery and nothing else. He is not taking your life because you do not have it as yet. He is taking only your death. He is not taking anything valuable from you because you do not have anything valuable. He is taking only the rubbish, the junkyard that you have collected through many lives, and you are sitting on the heap of the junkyard, and you think this is your kingdom, you think this is your position. He is not taking any. If you are ready to give your misery to him, you will become capable to receive his bliss, his awakening, his understanding. This is surrender. And then master becomes the door, God. Anything, anybody you surrender becomes the divine to you. Surrender brings divineness, creates divineness around you. Surrender Surrender is the creative force of the existence. Surrender is the creative force of existence. It brings something in you and gives you the taste of your own freedom.